大家好，我是纪大伟，我在台北，我很荣幸可以在 AAWW 这个平台，也就是亚裔美国作家工作坊，跟大家分享我跟台裔美国新锐作家朱永石共同编辑的《酷儿时间台湾同志文学》专号。My wonderful colleague Ariel Lu is a Taiwanese American writer. After her residence in Taiwan.She is going to be a PhD candidate in literature and creative writing at the University of Southern California. I myself teach LGBT studies, disability studies, and Taiwanese literature at the National Chinese University in Taipei. I myself also publish science fiction.
Thank you all for joining us today to celebrate the launch of Queer Time, Taiwanese Tongzhi Literature, a special notebook sponsored by the Trans-Pacific Literary Project at the Asian American Writers Workshop. My name is Ariel Chu. I've had the honor of co-editing this folio with Professor Ji Dawei, Associate Professor of Taiwanese Literature at National Chengchi University in Taipei.Over the last few months, we've been working closely with Taiwanese authors and translators from all over the world. This collection of queer Taiwanese literature would not have been possible without the dedication, effort, and enthusiasm of these authors and translators, several of whom you will hear from today. Queer Time challenges normative history, bringing to light the fragmented narratives, asynchronous lifestyles, and suppressed voices of marginalized subjects. In Taiwan, time has never been straight.Navigating successive colonizing forces, multiple language communities, and modern geopolitical tensions, Taiwan has enjoyed a legacy of non-heteronormative literature, at least from the 1960s up until the present day. This notebook is both a continuation of and departure from Taiwan's legacy of queer and non-heteronormative literature, also known as Tongzhi Wen Xue, in many Sinophone countries.The pieces in this collection highlight queer subjects living in a uniquely queer nation, not merely for its legalization of same-sex marriage in 2019, but also for its contested sovereignty, its competing official histories, and its fraught search for a cohesive identity. Today, you'll hear from authors and translators whose works encapsulate this queer sense of time and place.Lin Xinghui's Peeling Off, translated by Odelia Lu, takes the capitalist present of Taipei to the extreme, positing a world in which people's very bodies are eroded by consumer culture, loneliness, and corporate disillusionment. Petit or Sha Mu Cong's Military Dog, translated by Yahia Zhengtang Ma, explores a local BDSM subculture, subverting the normative dynamics of compulsory military service.Leah Yang's Nobi Nobita's Body, translated by Jenna Tang, uses a series of flashbacks to trace the protagonist's relationship with other bodies and her own. And Yang Shuang-zi's Seasons of Bloom, translated by Lin King, follows a time-traveling young adult as she navigates her feelings for another woman in Japan-occupied Taiwan.We're proud to present a bilingual reading, in which the Taiwanese authors of these pieces will first read their works in Mandarin, followed by their translators reading the same excerpt in English. We are also happy to present a conversation between Petit and Yahia Ma on the process of translating Military Dog and what it means to queer translation. All the pieces you hear today will be published on the AAWW website in both English and Chinese, in addition to the incredible works of many other authors and translators not featured in this reading. Please, join us in celebrating the launch of this special notebook of queer Taiwanese literature.
Lin Xinghui 现在是政治大学台湾文学研究所博士生，他的第一本小说集《瑕疵人形》得到2020年台湾文学经典奖，他也是一位很活跃的科幻评论者。
I'm pleased to introduce Lin Xinghui, who will be presenting an excerpt of her short story Peeling Off in Mandarin. Lin Xinghui is a science fiction writer and literary critic based in Taipei, Taiwan. She's the author of the sci-fi short story collection Human Glitches, which investigates the blurring boundaries between humans and non-humans, the surreal moments that happen in our mundane lives,and the loss and loneliness that consume us in the age of technology. As a debut novelist, she was awarded the 2020 Taiwan Literature Award for Books, one of the major literary prizes in Taiwan. In addition to creative writing, she frequently publishes reviews and essays on major media, intersecting literature with current events and cultural activities. Currently, she is a PhD student at the National Changshi University Graduate Institute of Taiwanese Literature.
不过，隔天仍和昨天一样，寻常的运转。一早打开新闻，和昨晚不同的女主播，右脸颊缺损一块，颊骨露出，但神情没有丝毫异样。女主播讲的是和昨晚雷同的台湾电视新闻独有的无聊内容，行车记录器的翻拍影像，网络传言的绘声绘影，各地餐厅的植入性行销报道，但偏偏没有任何一个关于身体少一块肉的新闻。通勤时，她多留意周遭，对坐的女子与其说是撑着右脸打瞌睡，不如说是捧着右边牙齿。身边站着穿西装的男子，左手一伸，没有皮肉的手腕探出袖口，手表扣在骨头上，扣到最紧了，仍然松松的垂掉。表面因重量转到下方，男子只能将手腕举起，由下往上看时间。然而，捷运仍然是台北捷运的平常样貌，宁静的车厢挤满所有上班族的疲惫与不情愿，唯一的声音是循环播放的到站铃声，提醒让座和禁止饮食的宣导。明亮而光洁的捷运车厢内，睡眼惺忪的台北市区里，似乎发生了什么，却又仿佛什么也没有发生。寻常与淡然平复了他心底的波折，让他原本紧盖在右手背上的左手逐渐松懈。直到他抵达信义区高耸的办公大楼，进办公室按指纹打卡，再收手时，才赫然发现右手大拇指的皮肤就这么粘在指纹辨识机上。他才又心慌起来，赶紧取下收进口袋。忽然比起自己又散落一些皮肤，他更加在意，如果食指手指头的皮肤都掉光了，该怎么打卡上班。回复客户时，他数度因此分神，切换视窗来到脸书，卷轴不停下拉，这才发现许多好朋友的自拍照，那些比耶的手势早已是两只细瘦的白骨。而脸书不愧为大神，已读他的困惑，回复以赞助广告，找回原本的自己。显示图内是一个女子的正面，左侧脸没有了皮肤，只剩下一只孤独的眼珠。女子手上捧着人体模型，模型的左侧脸就是女子遗失的面容，只差那个还留在女子身上的脸珠。模型的右侧脸则只有形体，但是没有脸容，一如服装店橱窗中的人形模特儿。点进连结才晓得，那是针对皮肉脱落者设计的人体模型，让人可以把自己剥落的皮肤、按照相应的部位连上人体模型，贴上人体模型的皮肉不会再掉落，而且每块皮肉之间的细缝也会在结合时完美修补，不留痕迹。有各种体型也可以选择，也可以只买一个部位。像他担忧的打卡，就有一款商品是大拇指模型，买家只需要将剥落的大拇指皮肤贴上，带着上班指纹打卡就不再是问题。于是他又回复几封信，再切换到人体模型的官网，打报表打得眼花缭乱时，又转到网页四处点阅。吃午餐时，他细读付款、配送、退换货的问题。晚上吃过饭，他忽然意识到不远的将来可能再也用不到面膜，便赶紧拆开周年庆买来的囤货。面膜的精华液凉冷贴肤，他掀开笔电进入网页，把一个人体模型放入购物车。接着是一连串繁荣的资料填写，身高、体重、背长、腿长、身长、脚长，根据购买者的体型，业者将配送最合适的模型。他依序填写，拿布尺测量，十分诚实。他并不奢望那个最终粘着自己皮肤的模型要成为广告明星那样的身材，只是到了最后一个选项，他仍然不够诚实，或者说他太诚实了，诚实的避不了那一闪而过的念头。不曾和男性交往过的他，在性别栏位中点选男性。结账的瞬间，他松松一省， 没留意敷得太久的面膜逐渐刺痒皮肤，一个人走不完的漫长日子，总算等到了一个会陪伴自己的男人。
Next, translator Ye Odelia Lu will be presenting the same excerpt of Peeling Off in English. Odelia is a translator and nonfiction MFA candidate at Columbia University. She has lived, studied, and worked mostly in China and in the US, and she mainly translates from Chinese. She is also the print translation editor for the Columbia Journal issue 59. Her work has appeared in Sine Theta magazine issue 11. Please welcome Odelia.
Yet the following day came around the same as yesterday, like a well-functioning cog. The anchorwoman for the morning news, different from the one last night, was missing a part on her right cheek, exposing the cheekbone. Despite bearing an expression that betrayed nothing unusual, the delivered news was almost identical to that from last night, featuring exclusively boring content that could only be found on Taiwanese news channels. Dashcam recordings, vivid descriptions of internet rumors, restaurants' reports on various advertising strategies, only missing the news about anyone's body losing a lump of meat. When commuting, she paid extra attention to her surroundings. The woman sitting across from her was not so much dozing off with her face propped up by her right hand as she was holding her teeth and facial bones in place. A man in a suit standing nearby stretched his left arm and a fleshless wrist poked out of the cuff. The watch he wore had its strap buckled to the tightest hole, yet it still hung loosely from the bone with a shifting weight that drew the watch's face downward, so that the man had to raise his wrist to read the time from below. Nonetheless, the Taipei Metro was its usual self. The cars were filled to the brim with office workers' silent fatigue and reluctance, the only sounds being the incessant ring of arrival announcements and the reminders about offering seats to others and prohibited behaviors like eating or drinking. In a clean, bright metro car, in the waking, blurry-eyed city, something seems to have happened, and yet nothing seemed to have happened. A sense of normalcy and nonchalance ironed out the wrinkles in her heart, loosening the grip of her left hand on her right. It was not until she arrived at a sky-high office building in Xinyi District, walked into the office, scanned her fingerprints on the employee's biometric time clock, pulled back, and saw the skin of her right thumb stuck to the machine that she grew nervous again. She tore the piece of skin down and stuffed it into her pocket. Suddenly, instead of worrying about additional loss of skin, she wondered how she could punch in for work if there were no more flesh left on all of her fingertips. Thoughts like that distracted her as she replied to clients' emails, prompting her to switch tabs and land on Facebook. The scroll bar kept scrolling down and down and passing many selfies taken by her friends. She realized from the photos that her friend's scissor hands, two fingers making peace signs, had long since become two thin, bare bones. And Facebook, being Facebook, had already read her confusion and responded with sponsor ads. Click to reclaim your original self. The image showed the frontal view of a woman whose skin and flesh on the left face were all gone. Only a lone eye remained. The woman cradled a head model in her arms. Its left face was exactly the one the woman had lost, minus the eyeball that was still intact on the woman's body. The model's half face was only a shape lacking character, similar to the face of a shop window mannequin. From the page that popped up, she learned that these were lifelike mannequins designed for people with fallen flesh so that the latter could paste their skin, their muscle, onto the corresponding parts of the former. Once put on, the flesh would never come off, and every tissue would align seamlessly with each other. There are multiple body types available, or you could purchase a part separately. For instance, to combat her punching situation, there was a thumb model. Customers only needed to press the flaked off skin onto the model, bring it to work, and enjoy a smooth, carefree scan. If you paid extra, you could even have a hole drilled into one end of the model. Why not add it to your keychain? Easy to carry, hard to forget, the item description went. So she shifted between client emails and the mannequin website. When statistical reports strained her eyes, she clicked the mouse here and there on the website, looking at models. While eating lunch, she attentively went through the payment, shipping, and return terms. After dinner, and a sudden realization that she might no longer be able to use facial mask in the future, she unwrapped a mask from the stocks she'd gotten during the brand's anniversary sale. As a blanket of cool liquid essence fit onto her skin, she opened her laptop, entered the website, and added a model to the cart. What followed was a long-winded list of information to fill out: height, weight, arm length, torso length, leg length, foot length. The supplier would deliver the most fitting model based on each customer's physique. She filled everything out in order, measuring herself with sewing tape in utter honesty. She did not really expect that her model, who would have her own skin glow on top, could have the body of those celebrities in commercials. Except she was not honest enough, or perhaps she was too honest, so much so that she could not shake off the fleeting idea that crossed her mind at the last question. As someone who had never dated a man, she ticked the box that marked male under the section for sex. The moment she confirmed the order, she broke into a half smile, not noticing the mask prickling her skin after being left on for too long. After all those lonesome days she could not see the end of, here finally came a man who would be by her side from this moment onward.
夏目聪是中文世界最负盛名的皮神愉悦和调教的专家跟小说家之一，他的小说《军犬》已经成为传奇，《军犬》也拍成电影短片，在很多国家放映过。
Next, I'm pleased to introduce a bilingual conversation between Petit and Yahia Ma regarding the history of the novel Military Dog and the process of querying translation. Subtitles for this conversation were provided by Jenny Zhang. Xia Mucong, or Petit, was born in 1977 and has independently published a zine and two novels. These novels primarily use the roles of gay men and BDSM gender fluidity to explore relationships and love. In August 2003, Petit began serializing Military Dog on a BDSM forum, allowing him to come out with his SM identity. In 2004, he organized Taiwan's first BDSM society with a group of like-minded friends. From 2011 to 2013, he participated in BDSM theater and presented dog training to the public in the form of performances. Military Dog has since been adapted into a short film for film festivals. Yahia Zhengtang Ma is a Chinese-English translator and PhD student in the Asia Institute at the University of Melbourne, where he is undertaking a research project on the translation of male same-sex desire in Chinese language literature through the lens of queer translation studies. In addition to the English translations of numerous texts about contemporary Chinese art, his English translation of Ji Dawei's 1998 short story How has been published in Queer Taiwanese Literature, A Reader, edited by Howard Chang by Cambria Press in 2021. Yahia's critical work has appeared or is forthcoming in Melbourne Asia Review, Intersections, Gender and Sexuality in Asia and the Pacific, TSQ, Transgender Studies Quarterly, American Journal of Chinese Studies, Taiwan Insight, and Translation Studies. Thank you both so much for joining us here today.
Good day, everyone. My name is Yahia Zhengtang Ma. I'm a PhD student from the University of Melbourne, Australia, and the translator of Xia Mucong's Military Dog, Junquan, an excerpt. Thanks to Professor Da-wei Chi, Ariel Chu, and the American Air Writers Workshop for putting this together. It's my great honor and pleasure to have had an opportunity to work on the Queer Time as part of the Trans-Pacific Literary Project. Today, I'm very honored to be joined by the author of Military Dog, Xia Mucong, for a conversation on the novel and its translation. Atong, so do you please introduce yourself and tell us how did you come up with the title for this novel and where your inspiration came from? Thank you.
大家好，我是夏木聪，军犬的作者。军犬是在一个华人的 BDSM 论坛开始连载的。 在公开连载之前啊，我其实是一直都在 SN 圈做潜水的动作，就是我只看别人的讨论啊发言，但我没有实际参与。一直到了那个论坛的版面上出现了一个限制积分的版面，就是我需要有一定的积分我才能够进去，所以我才开始使用透过写小说去累积积分。然后呢，当时的网络上面的 SN 小说，特别是男同志的部分，其实主要都只有在描述 SN 调教的过程，除此之外很少提及主角的背景或者是他的职业啊或生活之类的。所以我在写军犬的时候，我会特别想要从主角怎么遇到主人的，是怎么开始的，然后再到调教的过程，然后调教结束之后呢，他的生活有没有开始产生一些什么样的变化。所以呢，我会选择军犬当这个名字是从小说主角的职业设定开始的。那时候是有想了几个用途犬类的名字，像是军犬啊警犬之类的。不过当时因为我还才刚退伍不到两年的时间，所以对于军队文化或者是军队的制度方面的记忆其实还蛮新的。所以而且军人职业军人给人的感觉啊，就是那种强壮啊阳刚啊或男性高高在上的，所以当这样的男性在 SM 当中成为了全裸四肢跪在地上的狗奴的时候，其实高低落差就会产生一个很巨大的效果。而军犬本身就是一个只接受军事训练执行军事任务的犬只，所以当主角李军中平时是一位职业军人，而到了 SM 当中在主人面前是一只军犬的时候，我就会觉得以军犬为名来当小说的名字是非常适合的。
Well, thank you. And I believe our audience is very keen to know more about military dog. So, Atong, can you tell us a little bit about how was your writing process like?
军犬其实我写了很久，大概是从2003到2009六年的时间。然后呢，我其实就是把军犬开始连载就当做我个人的 SN 出道或者是出柜。前三部其实我写得很快，大概几个月我就写完了。到了后半段就是四五部的地方的时候，其实是伴随着我自己在 SN 方面的实践啊，对于很多人事物的疑惑探索，然后还有一些自己人生方面的困顿或迷惘之类的，就造就了我自己在写军犬后半段的时候花了蛮久的时间我才完成。对，然后我觉得那个创作的过程啊，其实是对于作者来说是一个身心灵的考验。其实我觉得那个翻译应该也是跟创作差不多吧，就是它也是另外一种形式的创作，基于原作再去做另外一个语言的再创作。所以我会很好奇你在翻译的过程之中有遇到一些什么样的事情吗，或者是怎么样，你可以讲一下你的翻译的过程之类的。
Okay, thank you. So generally, as a novel military dog queers the universalizing pretensions of queer desire and the fundamental notions of the erotic, the individual, and the body. So the translation project seeks to document the existence of the Taiwanese BDSM scene, which is very unique, and new sexual identities. So translating military dog into English has offered an opportunity for me as a translator to reimagine the pleasure of the text and desire for translating a text, which is a part of what I would call a queering translation. For example, in my translation, military dog's master is referred to as master with a capital M and him with a capital H to indicate a relationship between a handler and a puppy, as it is in real life BDSM scene. So naturally, Li Junzhong's pronouns ta, he, his, and ta, him, this military dog in English as his puppy name are presented in lowercase. So in doing so, I just tried to show the human puppy's respect, love, and worship towards his master, and to demonstrate that at least within the time frame in the excerpt, DT is the only and one master of Li Junzhong. And at the same time, I applied the combined first and third person narratives to refer to military dog to celebrate the fluidity and versatility of his sexual identity. And readers are assumed to understand that I am he, in lowercase, is the slave or the dog. So furthermore, the translating process offered me an opportunity to rethink what I mentioned earlier, the queering of translation. By queering translation, it does not mean to seek equivalence across linguistic and cultural borders, but to rethink how we can disentangle some of the established binarism around the relationships between translation and sexuality, the source and targeted equivalence binarism in translation, and question long established gender roles and heteronormative sexuality, and undermine the regime of homolingual address and the model of heterolingual address. So now let's move on to the next question for Atong. I remember that in an interview, you mentioned that 军队是一个巨大的 S&M 调教场, the military is a huge S&M venue. So do you please elaborate on this, Atong?
我在一些访谈中有提到过这句话, 而我自己啊是在 入伍当兵服役前是对SM其实是没有太大特别的感觉的, 是随着我的当兵, 然后SM才开始慢慢的觉醒。 为什么说军队是一座巨型的SM调教场呢? 军队其实是一个将社会上来自于各个地方的男性集中在一个地方, 然后剃了他们的头发, 然后每个 士兵都只剩下一到两公分左右的头发这么长而已，然后换上了只有几个尺码的可以选择的军服，然后他们被集中在一起出操训练，把不同不一样的人，然后捏造成同一个模样，而且军队又是一个讲求纪律、阶级、服从的地方，其实它的本质其实就是SN。 只是他叫军队，然后他也没有所谓的知情同意，然后被虐者也没有所谓的高潮。然后呢，台湾大部分的男性都有服兵役的义务，这也是为什么台湾的男同志在SM跟恋物方面通常都跟军队、军人有很大的关联。嗯，Okay,
thank you for your very fascinating explanation, which I really, really love. Well, so to conclude, I would take this opportunity to recommend Military Dog to everyone. If you like queer erotic books that you cannot put down, then Military Dog will be just perfect right for you. But you know, it is not your regular queer or erotic or even pornographic book, you just name it, about sexual identities, sexualities or communities. So I would say ultimately Military Dog challenges the popular perceptions of sexuality, gender, and sexual freedom, and questions the binary understanding of sadomasochism. So I guess that's all I want to say. So Atong, do you have anything else to add?
在那个军犬连载到出版的过程中啊，我们这群人其实还蛮常讲着我们是看着军犬长大的。 这里其实是有两个意思，一个是把小说拟犬化，就好像看着真的看着一只小小的小狗诞生，然后慢慢的长大，变成一只很大很大的狗，或者是另外一个意思是指说话的人自己的长大，就是随着年纪啊，或者是人生经历的增加，可是不管哪是哪一个，其实都是在讲着这部小说其实陪伴着很多人度过了一段时间，然后这一次的那个翻译。 翻译就产生了，好像产生了另外一只的小小的小小狗，然后我就很希望可以有机会可以看到这只小小狗的长大，然后变成一只勇敢又坚强的军犬。嗯，我觉得大家都可以一起陪伴着它。
杨丽雅的散文集《女子汉》是她的成名作，以探讨多元性别议题著称。她这一次的小说《大雄的身体》也让人重新思考身体的界限。她在亚洲各国的文学场域都很活跃。
Next, I'm honored to introduce Yang Liya, or Leah Yang, who will be presenting an excerpt of her short story, Nobi Nobita's Body, in Mandarin. Leah was born in Taipei, Taiwan, in 1984. An essayist and novelist, Leah published a first collection of essays, Nüzi Han, in 2017. Many of Leah's works have been published in online newspapers and literary magazines in Taiwan and Shanghai. Leah has also served as the Chinese Literature Biweekly guest writer at the University of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur, and has also been invited to participate in numerous exchanges with the Beijing Writers Association and Shanghai Writers Association. Leah's creative writing focuses on themes such as the lives of contemporary urban women and issues surrounding multiple gender identities.
大家好，我是杨丽雅。今天想跟大家朗读一篇我的短篇小说，叫《大雄的身体》。大雄就是那天开始成为大雄的。茶饮店靠近学校跟捷运站，下午四五点是最悠闲的时候。学生跟上班族的午茶都送完，又还没到晚餐时间，没什么客人，大家窝在店里，天南地北瞎聊。大雄一边搅拌煮粉圆的锅炉，一边跟小夫聊起中学时的宿舍生活。我们同寝室几个女生被安排打扫教官宿舍，结果在抽屉的公文部搜出一排保险套。那时大家对性都很好奇，音乐班一个嘴巴很大的女生把保险套当气球吹，哎呀我的妈呀，我还记得她大叫好油，为什么会这么油，油油黏黏，但是她看起来很开心，而且嘴巴张得比平常吹乐器还大，大口朝里不断吹气。没想到那些保险套很快就变成绍兴时候的那些气球。哎呦，我不敢听了，好色哦，你们这些年轻人赶快再多说一点啦。小夫夺过大雄手中的搅拌棒，帮忙搅起粉圆。有点像童玩吹泡泡那样吧，所有女生在宿舍把泡泡用手掌顶过来顶过去都玩得很开心。可是什么，赶快说啊。小夫窃笑，为什么教官会需要在值班室放保险套？印象中他有太太跟一个读小学的女儿，每周也只有一天需要住在学校，而且总是很晚来很早起。大雄回忆中学时的宿舍，虽不是男女混宿，不过男女生的住房也只相隔一块中庭空地，除了午夜象征性关上一道铁门，除此之外没有任何围墙的阻挡。大家忙着吹泡泡玩泡泡，在泡泡里从17岁来到18岁。我高中的时候就想做胸部了，小夫在大雄耳边低声嘿嘿笑两声。他们一起合力抬起粉圆锅，加入冰水冲洗。两个人靠得很近的时候，大雄发现小夫皮肤白，但下巴跟嘴角边缘的胡渣很密集，一直看得专注，差点接不上话。人家都说有胡子才是美女哦，大雄慌忙回应。哎呀，我们新来的试货眼光真好，等我存够钱，我下面也可以去做，动手术真的好烧钱哦。小夫笑了。大雄把视线往下移动，看向小夫的裤裆拉链，一座小山隐约起伏。再恍然看回小夫前方，精巧浑圆，如同鲜奶馒头的胸部。跟你讲啦，我就是太心急太早做，现在其他人都能做水滴型啊，哪像我这两颗，每天洗完澡就要好好按摩耶，不然硬得跟石头一样，哭哭。小夫把粉圆挖起，一勺一勺加入已经调好的黑糖水。你的可不可以借我摸一下？还没等大雄同意，小夫的手已经伸进里面的里面。哦，人家就是想要这种的，好软哦，好 Q 哦。这时基然跟王聪明也走进来，所有人都哈哈大笑。大雄觉得自己跟小夫没那么熟，而且被人这样摸真的很不自在，但是大家都在笑，基安、王聪明、小夫都好开心，包括后来的静香，所有人都哈哈的笑着。大雄不知道怎么办，他也只好跟着笑，哈哈哈哈，发出两次生硬的笑声。 好了，跟你开玩笑的。我去前面准备客人要的普巴奶茶，小夫提着粉圆桶往外场去走，看着小夫跟王聪明纤细的背影，那是大雄梦想中的模样。学生时期那么多的王聪明又高又瘦，在球场上奔驰，偏偏自己只擅长田径，家里还不让他剪短发，只好把长发高高绑起，一串马尾在后脑勺摆来摆去，打着令人不悦的节奏。比起考试，他更恐惧每个长假或春节的到来。每次返家的深夜，晒在阳台的网购束胸不止一次被早醒的母亲剪碎丢在垃圾桶，说这种阿萨布鲁的东西影响发育，做女人有什么好丢脸，又不是生你胸大无脑，多少人想要傲人双峰，你还不懂珍惜啊。边说边把菜市场买回的几件黄色蕾丝胸罩塞回返回宿舍的行李袋。
Jenna Tang, translator of Nobi Nobita's Body, will read the same excerpt in English. Jenna is a Taiwanese writer, literary translator, and interpreter based in New York. She translates from Mandarin Chinese and Spanish and received her MFA in fiction, creative writing from the New School. Her translations are published in Restless Books International Anthology and We Came Outside and Saw the Stars Again, Latin American Literature Today, and more. Her interviews can be found at World Literature Today and Words Without Borders. She is one of the selected translators from the 2021 ALTA Emerging Translators Mentorship Program with a focus on Taiwanese prose. Please welcome Jenna.
Hello everyone, I'm Jenna Tang, and today I'm going to read an excerpt from Leah Yang's Nobi Nobita's Body. And that was how Nobita had become Nobita. The tea shop was closed to schools in an MRT station. By 4 or 5 in the afternoon, they would have finished delivering all the orders to schools and offices, and then they would have the rest of the time to themselves. It was not close enough to dinner time, so no new customers would come in. All of them stayed at the shop, claiming different corners and chatting with each other. While stirring a boiler for cooking boba, Nobita began talking with Suneo about her life in the high school dormitory. Me and several girls in my dorm room were assigned to clean the school's military officer's dorm, and when we opened a drawer, we found a box of condoms in a folder. At that time, everyone was curious about sex. There was a girl with a big mouth from music class. She would blow a condom the way she did with balloons. Oh my god, I still remember that she kept yelling, "So greasy! Why is it so greasy? So slick and oily!" But she looked like she was having fun. Her mouth opened wider than when she was playing her instrument. She kept blowing into the condom, never expecting that those condoms would very soon become the balloons for the school anniversary. "Oh my, I can't hear this anymore! So lewd! You young people, tell me more!" Suneo took away the stirring rod from Nobita and began to stir the boba. Everyone blew the condoms up like bubbles, and all of the girls from the dorm tapped and passed the long-lasting bubbles with their palms. Everyone was enjoying themselves, but then... "But what? Do tell!" Suneo sniggered. "Why did the military officer put condoms in his office? What's the need? Didn't he have a family? I remember he had a wife and a daughter in elementary school. He only had to stay the night at school once a week." "And he always arrived very late and woke up super early." Nobita recalled the dormitory she had stayed in during high school. Even though it had been one that separated boys and girls, the distance between their buildings had been nothing but an empty patch of middle ground. Besides closing the metal gates ceremoniously at midnight, there had been no walls at all. Everyone had been busy blowing, hitting, and playing with bubbles, and in a bubble, they had grown from 17 to 18. "I've been wanting to get breasts since high school." Suneo laughed deeply in Nobita's ear. They lifted a big boba pot together, adding ice water and rinsing the pearls. They were so close to each other that Nobita was able to see, despite Suneo's pale skin, that she had dense stubble on her chin and at the corner of her mouth. For a second, Nobita watched so intently that she almost lost her place in the conversation. "Everyone says stubble makes a beautiful girl," Nobita replied quickly. "Aya, our new girl knows what to say. Such a good taste. I'll get bottom surgery when I save enough money. Surgeries cost so much, literally burning all my savings." Suneo blinked and laughed. Nobita moved her eyes underneath, looking at Suneo's zipper at her crotch. A slight bump like a small hill. And then in a trance, she looked back at Suneo's round, fresh steamed milk bun-like breasts. "Let me tell you, I was in too much of a rush. I did it too early, and now everyone else is doing teardrop implants. Unlike me, with these two, I have to massage them every day in the shower, otherwise they're going to stiffen like rocks. Stop." Sunil scoop up boba, adding brown sugar water, one scoop after another. Can I touch yours? Before getting Nobita's consent, Sunil reached her hand very deep inside of her clothes. Oyo, this is the type I actually want. So soft, so bouncy. Just then, Jian and Wang So Smart walked in. They pointed at Nobita and Sunil, laughing out loud. Nobita felt like she had only just got to know Sunil. The way Sunil touched her really made her uncomfortable. But then everyone was laughing. Jian, Wang So Smart, Sunil, and Shizuka, who later pulled back the curtain, they all seemed so cheerful. Everyone just kept laughing, and Nobita didn't know what to do. All she did was laugh at them. As stiff as it sounded. All right, I was just joking with you. I'm going to the front to prepare the boba milk tea for an order. Sunil lifted a bucket full of hot and fragrant boba and walked toward the tea shops and prepping area at the front. She watched the backs of Sunil and Wang So Smart, so thin and exactly the ideal look Nobita had always hoped for. When she was still a student, there were so many Wang So Smarts, tall and strong, playing on a basketball court. But she was better at running than at playing any kind of ball sport. At home, she was not allowed to keep her short hair, so all she could do was tie up her long hair into a ponytail, letting it dangle left and right at the back of her head, beating an unsatisfying rhythm. She was more afraid of the arrival of a long vacation with a Lunar New Year festival than of any of the exams she had. Whenever she arrived home late at night, she would hang the chest binder she bought online from the balcony, only to find it cut into pieces and thrown into the trash by her mother, who woke up early. Her mother said this kind of asabudo thing would affect her physical development. What's so shameful about being a woman? It's not like you are brainless with huge breasts. So many girls want big full breasts like yours. Why don't you cherish what you have? As her mother nagged, she stuffed several yellow lace bras she'd bought from a traditional market into the luggage Nobita planned to bring to school. Thank you so much.
杨双子擅长把女同志跟历史小说结合在一起。这一次我们刊载的作品就是她的代表作《花开时节》的节选。她跟她的妻子已经完成同志婚礼。
Now I am pleased to introduce Yang Shuang-zi, who will be reading an excerpt from her novel Seasons of Bloom in Mandarin. This novel is about a young woman who accidentally time travels back to Japan-occupied Taiwan, having to navigate her feelings for another woman amidst newfound familial obligations. Yang Shuang-zi was born in Taizong in 1984. The pen name Shuang-zi, literally twin, is in memory of her twin sister who was also a writer. She started to write fiction in 2003 and to publish lesbian fiction with allusions to Taiwanese historical details. Devoted to themes such as women's love for women, she is concerned with gender equality, Taiwanese folklore, and the public history of food. She lives with her wife and two cats in New Taipei.
学子心里脑里一片空白，确定无法往内地升学的那一刻起，学子就陷落在无法看见未来的迷雾之中，没有办法知道下一步会走到哪里。可以确知的是，如果终究要走到婚配这条道路，遭罪夫婿绝对远比嫁人为父更为理想。不对，遭罪夫婿背后所蕴含的意义是，学子可以守着知无堂，并且在未来各种危机之中，成为引领知无堂方向的主事者。如此一来，即使不去内地读书，只要学子到时候下了举家搬迁避世的决定，这个愿望就有实现的可能性。保全知无堂上下度过各种可能的劫难，这不就是学子想要的吗？可是红棉床前脚踏板凳上的学子，心里脑里一片空白，有寒铁一样坚硬冰冷的东西堵在胸口。那个秋凉的立冬时节，阿妈的宽敞红棉床铺，纱帐里学子坦诚无法履行同去内地的约定，小枣流露出复杂的表情，惊讶、困惑、迷惘、思索。沉吟片刻后，浮上脸庞的是明显的痛色。难道没有别的？小枣甚至没有把话说完就沉默下来。 学子一度以为像小枣这样坚毅的女孩会发出抗议。那个当下，小枣却对此没有多说一句话，脸上沉痛的表情意味着她对学子立场的深刻理解。小枣不希望为难学子。尽管如此，小枣仍然在度过寒冬的新春季节奔跑在兴盛桥通，碎发凌乱，眼睛泛红。雪，这样太奇怪了。这一定是小枣的心声。学子胸口鼓胀，想要过去紧紧拉住小枣的手，奔走到没有人知道的远方。现实中，却只能打断小枣的话语，转身走向与小枣脚步相反的道路。蒸汽火车尖锐鸣笛，王田车站前方魁星商店的招牌闪耀，等在那里的美国轿车反射斜阳光线，全部都刺痛学子。回家的路上，轿车里宪文哥抽了三根烟，直到车轮滚进自如堂的庭院。听说连校园里都有你要遭罪的留言了。宪文哥消息真灵通，满千金不知道，表少爷吩咐不少人去探听了。林 A 闭嘴，宪文哥严厉的呵斥，别说林司机吓一跳，学子也顿时醒觉过来。火柴插响，燃起红焰，宪文哥点了第四根烟。我可以让学子过你想过的日子，包括让你继续读书。宪文哥，这是想要入罪的意思吗？哼，小学子长大了，还是什么话都敢说。宪文哥笑了一下，吞吐着烟云。学子，只要知道一件事，你的结婚对象，我会是最好的人选。轿车缓慢、平稳地绕过半月池，在铺满红土石的外层停下来。外层越过矮墙，里头是背负着四只羊家自清国以来无数岁月的大红厝。沉着果脯的自如堂，傍晚彩霞映照如浓血，如深沉的红宝石，气势逼人。学子凝望的痴人，那里仿佛有无数身影，树忽闪翅，阿嬷、阿母、阿郎姑、秋霜官，还有那如花盛开的春子姐、恩子姐、豪子姐，以及惠峰哥哥。
Last but not least, Lin King will present the same excerpt of Seasons of Bloom translated into English. Lin King is a writer, translator, and teacher from Taipei. Her work has been published in Slice, Columbia Journal, and eFlux, among others, and has been awarded the Penn Robert G. Dow Prize for Emerging Writers. She is currently pursuing an MFA in Fiction and Literary Translation at Columbia University, where she teaches first-year writing. Please welcome Lin King.
Yukiko had felt like somebody had emptied out both her heart and her mind. From the moment grandmother had declared that studying in the mainland was now out of the question, Yukiko had been plunged into an impenetrable fog. She could not see the future, could not guess what her next step would be. What she did know for certain was that, if it was necessary for her to marry at all, taking a husband under the Yang name was far preferable to marrying into some family far from home. No, but that wasn't all.The implication of taking a husband under her name was that Yukiko would be the one to inherit Dirudong. She would become the family's next pillar. She would be able to steer Dirudong away from the various dangers that she knew were coming in the near future. Even if she could not realize her dream of studying in the mainland, she could still realize her dream of repositioning the family to avoid the brunt of the coming wars. She could, in short, ensure that every single member of Dirudong would survive.Was that not what she wanted? And yet, perched on the footstool before grandmother's feet, Yukiko had seen nothing, felt nothing. Something hard and cold like frosted steel had blockaded her chest. That conversation had taken place in the beginning of winter, back when the air had still stirred with autumn breeze. One day soon after, while Yukiko and Sachan had been taking their customary nap on grandmother's broad wooden bed,Yukiko had confessed that she would no longer be able to fulfill their promise of going to the mainland together. Under the silk canopy, a series of expressions had clouded Sachan's face, shock, confusion, distress, deliberation. After a few moments, her countenance has settled into what was indisputably one of deep pain. Isn't there any other... Sachin had not finished the question before stopping herself. Given Sachin's strong will, Yukiko had thought that she would raise objections upon hearing the news. But in the moment, Sachin had not said another word. The agony in her face had shown that she had understood Yukiko's position entirely. She had not wished to make things more difficult for Yukiko than they already were. Despite all this, here they were now, months later, on this frigid spring day. The formerly reasonable Sachin had chased Yukiko all the way down Shinsaibashi Avenue, messy-haired, cheery-eyed. Yuki, this is all too strange. This must have been her true opinion all along. Yukiko's chest swelled. She longed to seize Sachin's hand and run off to some faraway land that nobody knew. In reality, however, all she could do was to turn on her heels and walk off in the opposite direction, away from Sachin. When Yukiko got off the train at her station, every sight and sound felt like a sharp sting. The shrill whistle of the steam engine, the bright banners of the storefronts, the sunlight reflecting off of the American car awaiting her by the station door. On the drive home, Hyun Bunisan smoked 3 whole cigarettes in a row. He only put out the last one when the car rolled into the Dirudeung Gardens. "Heard that even your classmates are gossiping about the rumors of your marriage," he said at last. Hyun Bunisan is well informed as always. Lin, the driver, chuckled. "Doesn't miss know? Master Hyun Bun sent out a bunch of people to scope out the news. Lin, shut your damn mouth." Hyun Bunisan's sharp rebuke not only made Lin jump, but also jolted Yukiko out of her stupor. The strike of a match, the flare of a flame, Hyun Bunisan lit his 4th cigarette. "Yukiko, I can give you the life you want, including, of course, letting you continue with your education." "Is Hyun Bunisan saying he'd like to take my last name?" "Ha! Little Yukiko-chan still says whatever she wants, even now that she's all grown up." Hyun Bunisan laughed, swallowing and exhaling smoke. "Just know this one thing. When it comes to your marriage, I am the best candidate." Yukiko did not know what to say. The car slowly circled the Half Moon Pond and pulled to a stop in front of Dirudeung's outer apartments. Behind the garden wall stood the Yang family's courtyard mansion, just as it has stood for countless generations since the Qing dynasty. Steadfast, enduring Dirudeung. The setting sun stained its red bricks into a blood-like color, as if the walls and roofs were carved from a dark ruby. Yukiko lost herself in the imposing sight. She could almost make out familiar silhouettes in the courtyard flickering in and out of sight. Grandmother, mother, Auntie Lan, Madame Chusung, and the young members of Dirudeung who reminded her of so many blooming flowers. Haruko-nesan, Onko-nesan, Yoshiko-nesan, and of course, Keika-nesan.
我们要感谢 AAWW 提供这个让台湾跟世界接轨的机会，让我们用中英对照的方式介绍至少10个台湾作者，并且搭配10个以上的翻译者。
This concludes our Queer Time launch event. Thank you all so much for celebrating with us, and a special thank you to those who joined us from outside the United States. Once again, I want to thank Professor Ji Da-wei, the Trans-Pacific Literary Project at the Asian American Writers Workshop, and the Henry Luce Foundation for making this programming possible. I also want to thank all the authors and translators who poured so much time and labor into this notebook. Please read the entire Queer Time notebook online at aaww.org, and please consider donating to the Asian American Writers Workshop to support even more Asian and Asian American literature. Once again, thank you all so much, and please stay safe.